Oh, yes, once again, you're listening to the Hour of the Time, and I'm still William Cooper. You know, lest some of the more impressionable listeners out there get the idea that the Jews really do own all the press and own all of Hollywood, let me set the record straight. What I was doing was making a point by parroting the idiots out there who really believe that crap. It's not true, folks. It's not true at all. You see, the news network, CBS, ABC, NBC, all of these things, ladies and gentlemen, are publicly owned corporations. Oh yeah, don't you just feel a little stupid right now? They're publicly owned corporations. Anybody can own the press. Anybody that wants to buy stock. You see, I revealed this to all the nuts and wackos and idiots out there, but since then we've gained a whole new crop of people who really don't understand how capitalism works. So I'd better explain it to you again, because last night while I was making a mockery of these racist idiots who believe that the Jews have taken over the country and they're in great danger of the blacks killing all the whites and all this other bullshit, started to refrain myself. You know, I get letters every once in a while from these hypocritical idiots out there who claim that they have virgin ears and they never heard a word like bullshit. They want me to rein in my cursing. Well, folks, go get a copy of the dictionary. Any dictionary that you want, bullshit is right in there, and there's nothing vulgar or obscene about it. It has a specific meaning which draws your attention very well to the meaning that I want to put across. But anyway, ladies and gentlemen, the media is owned by publicly held corporations. A couple of years ago, in light of the fact that everybody was complaining that the media never tells the truth, and that they wanted to see the truth in their newspapers and on their television set and everything, I started a campaign to buy a media company. See, if enough of us bought the stock in one company, we could control that company. We could control who got elected to the board of directors, and thus we could control the policy of that media corporation. And our listening audience bought an awful lot of stock. They bought so much stock that the company that we were trying to garner control of, the stock went up almost immediately. And I'm not going to tell you how many shares we bought. We bought a lot. And people were mailing me, according to instructions, their proxy vote so that I could go to the stockholders meeting carrying the proxy vote of all the listeners who bought stock in that media corporation, which was Gannett. And we were going to turn that company around and make them tell the truth. And then it just ran out of steam. Nobody bought any more stock. Nobody did anything. And we weren't even near close to even being able to have any kind of say. And it wouldn't have mattered if we'd bought stock in the cheapest company that we could get stock in with the lowest number of shares. We still wouldn't have come close to enough. You see, everybody talks a big game. But when we get out on the field, you know, and the referee blows his whistle, I'm the only one left on the field, folks. You all just fizzle out. You'd rather have a Budweiser or something, you know, spend your money somewhere else than in trying to save this country. You see, anybody can own the media. Anybody who's got the guts and the willingness to put their money where their mouth is and buy the stock. If all of these white Anglo-Saxon racist Aryan people out there really cared who owned the media, they would own stock in the media. Or they wouldn't have sold the media in the first place. You see, everything in this country at one time or another was owned by white men, who, according to the story I hear, were somehow tricked into giving up their country and giving up their businesses and giving up the media and giving up everything, giving up their genes. It's not true. You want to know what's wrong with this country, folks? Go look in the mirror, staring at you from that silver glass will be your enemy. And that's the truth. That's the truth nobody wants to hear. That's why you listen to Tom Valentine, love him so much. He keeps you chasing tails, keeps your mind off the truth. Tells you all about how Treasury Gate, through Tommy What's-His-Name, is going to bring back the reality of the money system in this country. It was a scam. Tells you by adding water to your gasoline, you're going to get more miles per gallon. It's a scam. That scam's been going on for so many years, it's unbelievable that anybody's still buying into that crap. And I could go on and on and on and on and on. You people really want to be scammed. And you accuse me of all these kinds of other crap. It's just pathetic, I'll tell you. Let me tell you something, folks, what I've learned. That if I really had a larcenous heart, if I really wanted to be a multi-millionaire time and time again, I've learned how to do it. All I have to do is get behind this console and behind this microphone and tell you what you want to hear and stroke you and tell you everything's going to be fine. And don't worry, the good book tells us how it's all going to end, so you don't even have to get involved. That's all I got to tell you. And I got to tell you about this wonderful new carburetor that came out that, you know, if you spit in this little cup and screw it down twice, three times, you're going to get 100 miles to the gallon. And, of course, I could sell you a little piece of paper that says that I'm going to register your claim in court. That means that when the Delta Force brings back all the gold, you're going to get millions of dollars in return for your little $300 investment. Shall I go on? And you'll just love to follow people like Trockman of the Militia of Montana, which, by the way, folks, really doesn't exist. You know what the Militia of Montana really is? It's a room where they have all this stuff for sale. And it's five guys who come in and sell you this stuff. It's a scam. If you don't believe me, go up to Montana and take a look for yourself. Our people already have. There's a sucker born every minute, said P.T. Barnum. And P.T. Barnum was absolutely right. And tonight I'm going to expose to you, once again, with new information, the biggest sucker con job of them all. Oh, yes. So, why don't we start off, ladies and gentlemen, with a little music about the astronauts who had the right stuff. Uh-huh. They were all consummate actors, some of the greatest liars that have ever walked upon the face of the earth. Don't go away, because I'm going to smack you upside the head again. Thank you. When you know what I know, that's all so funny. I mean, it's hilarious. I'm holding in my hand a new book. Remember, I've told you before, ladies and gentlemen, that whether I cannot prove whether or not any of our astronauts ever went to the moon, I can prove beyond any shadow of any doubt that the photographs and videotapes and the video coverage of the so-called Apollo landings on the moon are all fake. All of them, every single one, there's not one real photograph among the bunch that was ever taken on the moon. I can prove that beyond any shadow of a doubt, no problem. I have a degree in photography. It's easy. These people think we're so stupid, they didn't even do it right. And back when they did it, they didn't have the special effects technology and the computer capability that they have now. I mean, if they tried this now, they could have really fooled us. But they couldn't wait. See, they had to do it because they want world government by the millennium, by the year 2000 or shortly thereafter. And the only way that they could genuinely get people to buy the premise that extraterrestrials are visiting this Earth is to make people believe that we actually went to the moon. Now, like I said, I know there's a secret space program with a secret technology, and I believe we've been out there all over the place, to tell you the truth. I don't know where, I don't know when. I don't know exactly how, but I believe that we have. But I know and can prove that all of the photographs taken of the Apollo space program, the moon landings that were supposedly taken on the moon, and the videotape that was supposedly shot on the moon, and the film that was supposedly shot on the moon was not shot on the moon. And I've told you that many, many times. I have quoted to you from a book called Moongate. I've quoted to you from a book entitled We Never Went to the Moon. I have quoted to you my own findings of my own research and the research of others. And tonight I'm going to begin a narration from NASA Mooned America by René. Now, you can purchase this book from us, ladies and gentlemen. It has the photographs in it that tell the tale, that prove it beyond any shadow of a doubt, both black and white, and brilliant, beautiful color photographs that are official NASA photographs that you can order yourself. Unless they figure out that I'm doing this, and then pull those photos and don't let you have them anymore, which they've done in the past. So, don't be surprised if they do that. And ladies and gentlemen, if you'd like to have this book, NASA Mooned America, which is an incredible documentation of the proof that NASA has been lying to us for years, and it's indisputable, absolutely indisputable, and they've done so much to hurt the author of this book, I'm not even going to get into that. It's the same stuff that happens to me and has happened to other people who reveal the truth of what's happening in the world. The book is $30 post-paid, delivered to your door by UPS. This book disappears in the United States mail, so do not send a post office box. We will not send this book to a post office box. You must send us a physical address for delivery of this book because it's going to be shipped by UPS only. I'm going to tell you this again. This book disappears when it's sent through the United States mail. The only way we can guarantee that you'll get it is if you send us a physical address. And if you don't have a physical address, ask one of your friends if you can have it delivered to their address for you. It's $30 post-paid. make check or money order payable to Annie, A-N-N-I-E, Annie. Don't put anything else on there. And send it to the Intelligence Service, Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, spelled exactly like it sounds, show and low, just like you learned in school, Arizona 85901. The check or money order payable to Annie for $30, postpaid. Address your envelope to the Intelligence Service, Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona 85901. Now I'm looking at a photograph, ladies and gentlemen, in the beginning of the book. I mean, this starts right off the bat. It's a photograph of the astronauts practicing in the zero-G airplane. And this picture, which covered two pages in the book Carrying the Fire, a book written by Apollo astronaut Michael Collins, was snapped by a professional NASA photographer as the plane flew an outside loop to temporarily eliminate or cause the illusion of the elimination of gravity. The cabin is padded to protect the occupants from the inevitable fall that the instant the loop is terminated. Now, what I'm looking at here is Collins as he practices spacewalking. He's holding the propulsion rod in his right hand, and on the facing page, ladies and gentlemen, is the Gemini 10 spacewalk. This picture was extracted from the center section of the same book and was allegedly taken during a spacewalk on the Gemini 10 mission exactly 3 years before his Apollo 11 mission to the moon. Now, NASA claims to have landed the first man on the moon during this mission. He is shown holding a jet reaction propulsion rod with his left hand. But ladies and gentlemen, during that mission, Collins claimed that he lost his camera on the spacewalk. And we know it was a contrived excuse by NASA so they could turn a zero-G picture into one of the spacewalk and no one would ask why he wasn't carrying his camera. You see, because the picture of Collins, Michael Collins, on the Gemini 10 mission, or excuse me, the Apollo 11 mission to the moon. Wait a minute, where am I at? The Gemini 10 mission is exactly the same picture as Michael Collins practicing inside the zero-G airplane. The negative has been flipped. You can examine it with a microscope, a magnifying glass, anything that you want. It is exactly the same picture. They took the picture of Michael Collins practicing in the zero-G airplane. They eliminated the background, flipped the negative, and put a dark space background sandwiched with that negative and made the so-called picture of the Gemini 10 mission of Michael Collins doing a spacewalk. It is faked. On page 660 of Ain't Nobody's Business If You Do, written by Peter McWilliams, we find, quote, the film of Russia's first spacewalk was later proven to be a shot in a studio, end quote. And it's true. Now, I just turned the page, and here's something else. The author of this book, following a hunch, he had negatives made of both previous pictures. Then he had another negative made of the first photo reduced in size and flopped over. Collins is now practicing with his left hand, the same hand he used in the alleged spacewalk. He then had the Gemini 10 picture blown up until the figure of Collins was the same size as this one. He then rotated the blown up photo clockwise until the propulsion rod made the same angle across the page on both pictures. Even the expression of his face is exactly the same. And ladies and gentlemen, it is absolutely impossible that everything, every wrinkle on the spacesuit, every single blemish, every position of every strap could possibly be the same. But they are. You've got to get this book to see it. It will absolutely knock you out of your chair. It will overwhelm you. It's a very expensive book. It's expensive to reproduce because of the quality of the color photographs in this book. And the quality, even the black and white photographs, the quality is incredible. What this reveals is worth, I'll tell you what, ladies and gentlemen, if the only way I could get this book was by spending $300 for it, I would do that. So you're all very lucky, and I'm very lucky, that we could get this book and be able to offer it to you for $30 post-paid, delivered to your door. We are trying to negotiate with the author to be able to print this ourselves. If we can, and if we can find the right printer that will charge us the right price, we may be able to get the price down. But I got to tell you, it's very expensive to create color separations and print color photographs in a book. If you're producing the book in small amounts. Now, if we were going to make 200,000 copies of the book, it would be very easy to get the price way down. But we're not. And neither is the author. And not only that, most of the books that he's had printed, he's given away for free to people in important places, to congressmen, to try to educate those who make decisions. You see, because NASA's trying to scam us again into going to Mars. Only, folks, they're not going to go to Mars. They're going to do the same thing they did with the supposed moon landings. It's all going to be fake, phony. Now, he then rotated the blown-up photo clockwise until the propulsion rod made the same angle across the page on both pictures. Even the expression of his face is the same. Collins would have us believe that this picture was taken by a different person many months later. However, the negative of either picture placed over the print of the other produces a point-to-point coincidence until the binding line at the knee is reached. The missing area was removed when the photo was bound in his book. And that's the only part that differs. If we do the same to the original NASA picture, number 66-40127, which took over 18 months to get from NASA, the point-to-point coincidence continues to the soles of his feet. Why did NASA feel it necessary, ladies and gentlemen, to fake pictures and lie to us as early as July 1966? It is incredible. Now I'm going to read you the foreword, and then we're going to get into some serious stuff here. In October of 92, I received a large size, and this is, I'm reading directly from the book. So when I say I, it's the author. In October of 92, I received a large size, full-color, glossy, 180-page government publication called America at the Threshold. It was sent to me because I had responded a few years before to a NASA solicitation for ideas for space. My best guess is that they queried me because I am both a patented inventor and a past member of the high IQ society known as Mensa. While reading the book, I stumbled across my name printed smack dab in the middle of page A51. It was there because at least one of my ideas had passed the serial scrutiny of a number of special committees of judges. By this time, however, I had become a confirmed skeptic and had ceased to believe in NASA, the CIA, motherhood, and I was getting mighty suspicious of apple pie. I had discovered a book called We Never Went to the Moon, written by Bill Kaysing. This book fine-tuned my previous dissections of the so-called moon landings by pointing out things I had missed. For example, the lunar lander's pads did not sink into the soft dust, but the astronaut's boots did. Also, although thousands of photos were taken on each of the missions, not one ever showed the millions of stars that must be brilliantly visible at all times on the airless moon. I also realized that much of the $40 billion cost for this production had been probably ferreted away, either squandered in the Vietnam police action and in the CIA's secret war in Laos, or siphoned off to fill the back pockets of the producers. NASA's America at the Threshold is cover-to-cover propaganda about Project Outreach, which I was horrified to discover, is NASA's grab for our grandchildren's wallets, ostensibly to produce a trillion-dollar Martian hoax that can bankrupt our already debt-plagued country. And that's really what all this baloney is about: probes to Mars vanishing, strange pictures photographed by the Russian Martian probe, face on Mars, pyramids on Mars, a Martian city. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, the philosophers of far are Martians. The philosophers of fire are Martians. Remember that? I've been revealing this to you for a long, long time. And it's all baloney. For almost 5 months, my erstwhile, I'm back to the book now, for almost 5 months, my erstwhile publisher constantly questioned NASA. If they hadn't known about this book before, they sure knew then. The 25th, or silver anniversary of the safe return of the crew of the first moon landing, Apollo 11, came and went without the expected NASA hoopla and propaganda. Instead, the usually unapproachable Apollo astronauts began a series of TV and radio show appearances. I directly attribute this to my book and his activities, talking about his publishing. Unfortunately, he did everything but print the book. In a prosecutorial mode, therefore, I hereby accuse NASA, the CIA, and whatever super secret group that controls the shadow government of these United States of fraud on the grandest scale imaginable, of murder by arson, and of larceny of $40 billion plus in conjunction with the Apollo program that allegedly landed men on the moon. I also accuse them of violating a federal law against lobbying by government-funded entities and of serial murder of low-level NASA employees, witnesses, and other citizens who happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. And folks, all that's true. You're very carefully kept from that knowledge. Such accusations seem incredible because none of us ever want to believe our governmental father is deceiving us. However, by the time you, the reader and ultimate member of the jury, finish this book, the most trusting of you will have few doubts that NASA mooned America. No doubt whatsoever, ladies and gentlemen. He goes on, I remember watching the first astronauts land on the moon and wondering why the TV pictures were so murky. We watched two blurry white ghosts who did little or nothing while they lurked in the shadow of the lunar lander. NASA seemed to have lost 100 years of photographic progress. It was boring, but I believed. During the next few years, I caught glimpses of subsequent missions as they flashed in color upon my TV screen, and I believed. The pictures improved with each mission, and toward the end of the Apollo program, the moon buggy tore up the moon's surface while NASA began to talk up a Martian adventure. I still believed in apple pie, the CIA, and NASA. A few years later, I saw the movie Capricorn 1. Its plot involved a CIA hoax about a manned Mars landing. Did I relate that story to our moon missions? Nah. I still believed in NASA and the CIA. Then one day, years later, watching a TV show, I thought I saw the moon flag ripple on the airless moon in a breeze that did not exist. The worm of suspicion slid into my system. The worm of suspicion slid into my system. I then began watching NASA film clips very closely and with less emotion. As those rose-colored glasses slipped lower on my nose, I began to notice flaws in other pictures. The astronauts in their backpacks weighed less than 75 pounds on the moon. That's the astronauts and their backpacks, including their suit, weighed less than 75 pounds on the moon, yet they left deep footprints in the moon dust and gravel. I thought it odd that the blast of a rocket engine that lowered the 33,000-pound limb lander to the moon's surface apparently left no crater or mark of any kind upon the moon's surface, and apparently it didn't even blow away the dirt beneath the footpads. Strange. Here on Earth, clear footprints can only be left in soil that has some type of wetting agent in it. There is no wet on the moon. Recently, I read Moongate by William Bryan and discovered that the flag did ripple during the Apollo 14 flag salute ceremony. That author procured that film clip in 1980 from movie newsreels given to Hollywood by NASA. Don't go away, folks, because I got a lot more to tell you. In fact, Hour of the Time, ladies and gentlemen, is brought to you by Swiss America Trading. Now, if you lived on the moon, you wouldn't need real money. There's nobody up there to spend it with. And after you learn what's going to be revealed on this broadcast, and what we've already been revealing to you for the last 4 years, for those of you who are smart enough and intelligent enough to listen and really examine this, not believe what you're told, and don't believe what I'm telling you, look at it. Look at the scientific evidence with your own eyes, with your own ears. Work out the mathematics yourself. You'll find that nobody went to the moon in the Apollo space program. They may have gone in some other hidden space program, but not the Apollo program. And if they did, none of the pictures, photographs, or videotapes that they took up there or supposedly took up there, or allegedly took up there, were really taken there at all. They were taken someplace within the atomic energy testing grounds, probably around the site known as Mercury. But here on Earth, folks, you need real money. Because once all of these scams get exposed, once the foundation is pulled out from under the lie, it's all going to collapse in upon itself, including the economy, which is just as phony as the rest of this crap. So call our sponsor, Swiss America Trading, ladies and gentlemen. Do it now. Get your hands on some real money. Protect the assets that you worked so hard all your life to accumulate. Please, do it now. I don't want to see any of you get hurt. I don't care who you are. I don't even care if you're the bad guys. I wish we could all come out of this in one piece, in a world of peace, in liberty, with responsibility. Call 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-BUY-COIN. Tell them you're a steady listener to William Cooper in the Hour of the Time, and you'll get first class, number one, red carpet treatment. I guarantee it. That's 1-800-289-2646 or 1-800-BUY-COIN. The lunar rover, ladies and gentlemen, spun its wheels, the dirt and gravel sprayed backwards as it would here on Earth. But in spite of the moon's much lighter gravity, they say, the dirt hit the surface just about as fast. The only tangible proof that we landed on the moon was the pictures and 840 pounds of moon rocks. The rocks, without the corroboration of photos, are meaningless because they could have easily been fabricated in NASA labs using high temperatures and pressures. That's really the only difference between rocks found here on the Earth and rocks found on the moon. I began to closely examine every NASA picture that came my way and discovered that almost every picture on TV tape released to the public is flawed in some respect. All the pictures in this book have been previously published. The still pictures were taken with Hasselblads, at that time the world's finest camera, and some would argue that it's the most finest camera even today. As you will shortly see for yourself, no matter the film, whether color or black and white, they do not ring true. I had to ask myself, why would anyone fake pictures of an event that actually happened? And folks, when I seriously began to examine the NASA photographs and discovered what I discovered years ago, I was one of the very first people that began to talk about the fact that the photographs were fake years ago. Now more and more people are catching on and more proof is coming out. I was flabbergasted. I really couldn't understand. If this really happened, why would they fake the photographs? The only thing I could come up with is maybe they didn't want to show what was really going on the moon. In case some terrible accident happened, they didn't want to see the American people to see an astronaut die. And I actually tried to fool myself into believing that for a little while until I realized that that only applied to the video, the live video. It didn't apply to the videotape we were shown later that they supposedly brought back from the moon, or the film that they supposedly brought back from the moon, or the photographs taken with still cameras that they supposedly brought back from the moon. If nothing went wrong, all of that should have been real, but it's all fake. So René asked himself the exact same question that I ask. Why would anyone fake pictures of an event that actually happened? And he says, and I quote, "That's why I refer to them as FX pictures. In movie lore, FX stands for special effects, where Hollywood employs the best technicians to create magnificently authentic-looking fantasies. Apparently, NASA employed amateurs who attempted to recreate the brilliant sunlight on the moon by using spotlights in a dark studio. Many of the pictures have diverging or converging shadows, which indicate two or more spotlights. The sun, ladies and gentlemen, only throws parallel shadows on Earth or on the moon. If you look at the backgrounds of most NASA pictures, there is a relatively sharp transition line where anything beyond becomes smooth and featureless. This is a sure sign of a grade Z studio backdrop. Every time the American flag is shown, there's a great deal of light on it, even if it is on the shadow side of the lunar lander. Also, NASA never filmed either stars or planets. They would have us believe that on the moon, stars and planets do not exist. The reason is simple. Before the era of computer enhancement, the stars would have been impossible to fake accurately enough to fool the world's star buffs. And since the heavens, in relation to the moon and the earth, are always in motion, every photograph would have had to show the stars in a different position. The original TV pictures we saw were photographic horrors because the astronauts looked like ghosts. Why? Apparently the government-cleared TV cameraman filmed a magnified TV screen. In fact, as you will subsequently learn, there were no live television transmissions during Apollo 11 and 12. The pictures were intentionally blurred to make us believe that the simulations we saw were real. Almost all the pictures reproduced in this book include the date and the NASA number of the picture whenever possible so that you may order them direct from NASA if you wish to see for yourself. NASA is now preparing to take us to Mars the same way they took us to the moon. This time a small cadre of computer experts will astound us with photos created by the new digitized computer graphics which did not exist in 1969. Next time, we will have no way of determining the truth. And I can tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that it is possible to fake reality on a computer
to the extent that it is absolutely impossible to tell. People reading this book have found many other anomalies in these and other NASA photos. I even have a report that when some of the color pictures are scanned, the background dots in some areas are a different color, indicative of a composite photo using pictures made with different brands of film. I have not added to the text all of these reports because that would prevent you from discovering for yourself additional flaws. This new epic is called Project Outreach and will feature new space heroes who will struggle to overcome all obstacles in our one-country race for Mars. But it won't be one country, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to tell you right now, it'll be a combined team of Russian and American astronauts. Think about that. One world united, in one world government, and these heroes going forth into the unknown of space to a strange planet to confront the unknown visitors and the relics of a lost civilization. Can't you just see the headlines now? And we must all come together and sacrifice, make whatever sacrifice it takes to confront the reality of a technologically superior enemy from space. The first segments of this serial, which we will be able to watch in the comfort of our living rooms, will show the construction of a permanent space base between Earth and the Moon, and the struggle will be against cold and the pitiless vacuum of space. Next, the astronauts will risk life and limb building the first base on the Moon. It will end with a successful Mars walk and will be the greatest made-for-TV movie ever. The budget, paid by us taxpayers, will be over $1 trillion, stretched out over a decade. And next to the pyramids will be the greatest welfare project in the history of the world. Wally Schirra and Tom Stafford, in this next photograph that I'm looking at, are about to be rescued after splashdown on Gemini 6A. They claim to have made a space rendezvous with Borman and Lovell flying Gemini 7. From the front of the capsule, we see the base of a long fiberglass whip antenna. It is completely undamaged, and it is not retractable as the capsule cabin contains no antenna well. The capsules came from the factory gleaming with a silver film. This is charred by temperatures over 5,000 degrees during reentry. Anything not shielded by the forward ablative coating will burn up. None of the other Gemini capsules showed whip antennas after splashdown. Now, this antenna responds to frequencies not used in space and would only be of value in locating the capsule after it landed. Once the capsule was found, it would have no further value. Why do NASA apologists argue that the rescue divers installed this antenna after it was in the water? The only conclusion left is that this capsule never re-entered from space, but was parachuted from a cargo plane. On the cover of this book, folks, there is a photo, and NASA's official title of this photo on the cover is, quote, Astronaut Collecting Lunar Samples, Apollo 12, end quote. NASA contends that Pete Conrad took it of Al Bean on October 20, 1969. The NASA number of this photograph is AS12-49-7278. I've discussed this photograph before. I'm talking about me. I continue. At any one time, there were only two men on the Moon. Yet, as reflected in Bean's faceplate under magnification, Conrad is carrying no camera and thus could not have taken the picture. Conrad has his left arm straight down and his right elbow is down with his hand near his navel. We see a flat background surface with the horizon sharply delineated. On Bean's visor, we see Conrad and the horizon behind him closely matching the real one. If we examine Bean's shadow as reflected in his visor, we know by its length that he is less than 10 feet away from Conrad. Therefore, we know there is no steep hill between them. But the camera on Bean's chest is being viewed from at least 8 feet above the ground. Since there is no stand reflected between Bean and Conrad, apparently a camera boom was used, or the man on the moon is 10 feet tall and invisible. Now here are some other anomalies. On the upper left edge of this photograph are two structural pieces that slant toward the ground and seem to be holding a spotlight. The ground between that spotlight and Bean is unevenly lit, but the brightest area is around him. Impossible on the moon, where the sunlight is about 200 times brighter than the sunlight on the Earth. Everything is brilliantly lit if they were really on the moon. But the ground between that spotlight and Bean is unevenly lit, but the brightest area is around Bean. And even if they had spotlights on the lunar lander, which they did not, they always landed on the light side of the moon where there was brilliant sunlight. Even if they had spotlights on that lunar lander, they could not even compete with the brilliance of the sun on the moon with no atmosphere. All of this is consistent with spot-lit subjects in a photographic studio. The ground in back of Conrad is extremely well lit, which is also consistent with studio spotlights. These are all things I've revealed to you before. René found these things on his own, without my help, and surely without yours. Bean is holding in his right hand a polished piece of metal tubing that has no shadow side. Indeed, the bottom part, a round piece on the bottom of this tube, is brilliantly lit when it should be in total darkness. Was a flash used in sunlight that is 20 times or 20% brighter than Earth, they say. There's a second shadow that extends from Conrad forward and to his right. It is almost 180 degrees away from his regular shadow. NASA never told us that our solar system has two suns. How can an object have two shadows, each going in a different direction? How can two items in the same picture have shadows both going in different directions, ladies and gentlemen? Yet that is what we see in the photograph. I consider this picture to be one of the most flawed of NASA's Apollo Project's filmed documentation because there are so many things wrong with it. A picture is composed only of light and shadow, and by definition, the shadow must be on the shady side away from the light source. Basic rule in photography. And here, on page 6, incredible picture. This picture is entitled Apollo 16 on the Moon. As in most NASA pictures, the texture in the foreground abruptly ends just past Charles Duke, and the horizon shows space devoid of stars. The small rocks end, and the ground suddenly becomes featureless and smooth. And I can tell you, folks, it's because it's a painting, just like you have on movie sets. And you can clearly see it in this picture. There's no doubt whatsoever. It is obviously fake. NASA has stated that this is because of the moon's smaller diameter. Folks, optical perspective does not change because of the distance to the horizon. There was a geological marvel right under his feet, and he never saw it. Unless, of course, the marvel we are looking at was nothing more than an amateurish backdrop for a simulated shot taken in a secret movie studio. The large rock in the foreground had been clearly marked with a large capital C. My wife examined the C and discovered that it was a flap rock, the kind of papier-mâché rock that they threw at her when she visited a Hollywood studio. She saw that the bottom right corner had a crease similar to that caused by a folded wet newspaper. Showbiz rocks are created by wetting newspaper and adding paste, paper mache. Why did NASA carry fake boulders marked with a C to the moon? Oh, brother. Folks, when you see this stuff, you're going to cry. You're going to literally cry. And you can get these photographs yourself. And you don't even have to get these. Every photograph that NASA made and said was taken on the moon is fake and is easily proven fake. No problem. The shadows of the two rocks in the right side foreground are all parallel, which is as it should be. The shadows from Duke and the Rover are also parallel. However, ladies and gentlemen, both sets of shadows diverge from each other, which is impossible if the sun is the source of light. Only huge, power-hungry arc spotlights could cause these shadows to act this way. Has anyone ever seen a trackless vehicle leave abrupt right-angle tracks before? NASA claims they had four-wheel steering, which would have resulted in four separate sets of tire tracks. It looks like a stage crew dragged the rover around to the left just before this picture was taken. There are only two tire tracks, and they make perfect right-angle turns. Notice how crystal clear, and I'm noticing it, you can't, but I'm going to tell you, how crystal clear both the footprints and the tire tracks are. A man who lives and has tracked various animals in the Australian desert pointed out that clear tracks in deep dust require moisture or gases, otherwise they are no more than indistinct depressions. I've done some tracking of my own, and I instantly knew he was right. The only clear tracks we can leave on a sand beach, no matter if the sand is fine or coarse, is near the water. There are some ultra-fine man-made materials that will take a track when at normal temperatures, but no natural soil here on Earth has that property. There can be no moisture on the moon, especially during the daytime when surface temperatures are about 250 degrees. Couple this with the vacuum of space, which drastically lowers the boiling point, and any moisture would boil away in seconds. And yet every picture that was taken shows clear footprints. Now, folks, if you can get yourselves a bell jar and a vacuum pump and put dust in the bell jar, you can check this out yourself. With dry dust, with no air between the particles, produced by putting the dust inside a bell jar and pumping out the air with a vacuum pump, you can make no footprints, no impressions whatsoever, because the dust is brought together in the vacuum. The only way you can make prints is if the dust is in an atmosphere and there is gas or moisture between the particles of the dust. These are all things that you can do yourself. Bell jar doesn't cost much. You can probably find a vacuum pump at your local science class at the local high school. Now here's another one. NASA claims this picture was taken on the Apollo 16 mission. The hill in the background shows no sunlight whatsoever and seems to be under a moon cloud, yet there are no clouds. There's no atmosphere. When you examine the videotapes and the pictures, though, you'll see evidence of atmosphere and clouds and all kinds of things. The problem is there are no moon clouds. That hill is only part of an inferior backdrop where they forgot to put light. The shadow from the skinny flagpole is clearly visible and terminates in a very thin shadow of the flag itself, thus proving that the flag was extended dead away from the sun. Could there be another source of light to cause the visible side of the flag to show so brilliantly? And again, folks, here's something that is incredible. There's a dark electric extension cord that starts under the rock near the flagpole. It then disappears off to the right. How did that cord get from the LEM, the only source of power on the moon? If this cord was laid down on a crowded beach, it would be hours before the foot traffic could bury this much of it. This leads one to wonder how the rest of the cord was buried and why. Again, the shadow from the LEM diverges from the shadow of that same rock. Since there is no spotlight that can create a shadow in the sunlight, this proves that the sun wasn't the light source. It had to be two or more spotlights. But what really takes the booby prize, ladies and gentlemen, is that John Young, in this photograph, has leaped about 18 inches into the air and has outjumped his own shadow. The astronaut, ladies and gentlemen, has no shadow whatsoever. Which means that is a composite photograph made of two different photographs. a cutout negative of the astronaut combined with a mask and the background of the lunar lander and the flag. He's outjumped his own shadow. We all know, folks, that white men can't jump. But wouldn't you think that if you weighed only 65 pounds on the moon's 1/6 gravity, that guys with the right stuff could jump higher than this? And then, where is the shadow? Or were two or more equal sources of light focused on him at the same time? No, it's a composite photograph, ladies and gentlemen. Or will a NASA apologist claim that light moves slow enough on the moon to allow a man with the right stuff to jump right out of his shadow? We'll continue this tomorrow night. Don't forget, you can get a copy of this book. This book is incredible. The photographs are incredible. You can get the same photographs from NASA, or you can get this book and then order the photographs from NASA and compare them to make sure that this author did not fake anything, which I can guarantee you he did not. The book is $30 postpaid. We will not send it to a P.O. box because it must be delivered by UPS. Make check or money order for $30 payable to Annie, A-N-N-I-E, and send it to the Intelligence Service, P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. And folks, I'm so happy to be able to offer you this book. And this book is so expensive to make because of the photographs. We're not making very much money on this book. But every little bit helps us here. And this book, I guarantee you, will knock your socks right off. It will prove to you beyond a shadow of a doubt that I've been telling you the truth for the last, I don't know how many years, it's been a lot. Good night, and God bless you all.